Alrighty, so it's Wednesday, which means Max, yes, okay. So before we get into that, just to recap some things from Monday, right? We talked about this big category, starts with an F. Filters, yes, okay. So filters is going to be kind of the theme for the week, the thing that we're looking at in our different environments. And the one of the key things that we talked about on Monday, which should have been somewhat of a review, right, talking about earlier classes, or hopefully, I don't know, did you guys cover things like low pass, high pass in 161 in previous classes? I'm seeing some sheepish head nods. Okay, good, okay. It was good to kind of, I guess, recap those. Those are going to come up again as we're dealing with filters throughout the week, okay? As well as how to graph them, yes, the frequency versus amplitude graphs, okay? We looked at the spectrum object inside of Live, which is analogous to the spectroscope object inside of Max, right, which allows us to visualize what's going on over the course of the frequency spectrum and what's happening in the frequency domain. We also kind of highlighted a few, some terms, right, although I didn't maybe use these as well as I could have, okay? We talked about the frequency of the filter, but it's not that the filter has a specific frequency, it's that it has traits centered around specific frequencies, right? The cutoff frequency for a low-pass filter or a high-pass filter, that we wouldn't call it the cutoff frequency for a bandpass filter, we would call that the center frequency. It's where the peak is at the center of the bandpass. There's also this idea of resonance. You should have seen those knobs that were labeled, I think, it's probably truncated. They probably didn't write the whole full word resonance there. Probably said something like reson or something like that. Yes, in Live. Okay, that's what that is. Is how much of a, you can think of resonance as kind of a bump at the cutoff frequency, if you will. Okay, the idea that you're going to get a little bit of a boost right around where the transition is from the pass band to the stop band. And some of those terms, pass band, stop band, that I introduced on Monday came up in your reading for tonight. Yes. Pass band, stop band, those types of things, okay? The slope, that was the, if you remember, I was looking at the switch that switched from 12 to 24, right? How quickly it changes. I talked about it being dB per octave. It's 12 dB per octave. That's the slope of the curve going from the pass band to the stop band on your filter, okay? All these are traits that we can control as we design filters or as we look at other filters that have been designed for us, because I don't have I don't have the false hope of that you're all going to become filter designers yourself and get into the minutia of details that it takes to design individual little filters yourself. But you want to be well versed in how filters are, or versed enough in how filters are designed, so that you understand what it is you can do with them, what kind of tasks you can accomplish with your various filters. Okay. So that brings us to what we were reading for tonight and looking for today, excuse me. And in looking through it, there was some confusion about parallel versus cascade. These terms came up as things that people were kind of fuzzy about. Did anybody kind of get what we were talking about? Because I've been using maybe a different word in terms of cascading, yes? There was another kind of opposite I've been throwing against parallel. What was that? Series, yes, okay. So cascading is really just a different way of saying putting filters in series, okay. So when you cascade filters one after another, where filter one feeds into filter two, feeds into filter three, you're cascading the effect of those things, okay. Why do we have to pay attention to whether things are in parallel or cascading? Why would that be important, Solomon?
Well, with cascading, you're going to have the very first filter be affected by all the filters after.
Yeah.
Parallel, each of them is going to output separately or into something else. They won't be affected by the other filter.
Yeah, they won't be affected by the other filter. In parallel, their outputs are then mixed together and then sent to your overall output. In cascading, the effect of one, I'm trying to not use the word effect again. The output of one affects the input of the next one, affects the input of the next one, etc. Okay. Why this is important? Well, imagine a scenario where you have a low-pass filter where the stop band starts. The stop band starts. Sounds funny to say it that way, but the stop band begins at about 200 hertz, right? Which means that everything above 200 hertz is pretty much being suppressed, right? So now if you feed that low-pass filter into a band-pass filter where the center frequency is set to 2,000 hertz, are you going to hear much effect of that 2,000 hertz band-pass filter? The answer is no, right? Because you're boosting frequencies that have already been cut out by the first filter, okay? So if you cut out frequencies with the first filter and then you try to boost them with the second filter, they're interacting with each other. They're affecting each other, okay? So you have to kind of understand that it alters the way the output ultimately is determined, okay, by putting them in this parallel or cascade. Hopefully this will become apparent as you start to work with filters. I didn't want to dwell too much on it today, but other than just to point out the fact that cascade, if you were confused by the term cascade and the fact that it was being used in the reading, I've been talking about it in terms of series, moving things in series, okay? The other thing that was people mentioned as being confusing was this biquadratic equation, or talking about biquadratic filters, yes? When it got into the deep into the weeds of the math of the biquadratic filter, did some of your eyes just roll back in your head at that point and say, this is why I'm not a math major? It's okay to admit it. You're not on camera, you can, okay. I want to dwell here just a little bit to hopefully demystify what that long chain of numbers meant, okay? I'm going to do this really quickly, but hopefully in doing it quickly, I can demystify what that long chain of numbers and letters actually means and how you can kind of parse it. It's almost like if you've learned a foreign language, right? Okay, you ever heard a foreign language that you don't actually speak, you've never studied before, you don't know where the periods are, where the ends of sentences are, which ones are the nouns, which ones are the verbs, right? Okay, you understand syntax for your own native language and maybe a secondary language that you've studied, but if you come across a foreign language that you don't understand, you don't know what the different parts of speech are, and so you don't know how to parse it, right? Okay. Part of, I think, where the math in this case, if we can just get to the point where you understand how to parse the equation, that would be a win in my column, basically, okay, helping you understand these things. Because these formulas do come up in the literature on computer music, because people that design filters have to express them with these mathematical formulas, because these mathematical formulas actually determine how we program them inside the computer, okay? And so if you're going to program a filter, you need to understand how to do this stuff, okay? So let's start with analog versus digital, a dichotomy that you're familiar with, yes? Okay? In mathematical expressions, in engineering documentation, okay, there's actually a way to express the difference between analog and digital. And the key thing to look for are these parentheses. If it's parentheses with an NT inside of it, that's an analog signal. If it's a bracket like this, if it's a square bracket, it's a digital signal. Now, those of you that have taken Intro to Computing, where have you seen these square brackets before?
Arrays,
yes. Okay, we're starting to jog the memory, maybe. Those of you that have taken Intro to Computing, okay, if you haven't taken Intro to Computing, learn to program. It's very important for being a 21st century citizen, okay? 21st century literacy, how to program, okay. Anyway. Now, so analog, digital, okay? X basically means that it is an input, okay? So when you see X, you're seeing an expression of an input source, okay? So in this case, we're looking at the conversion from an analog signal to a digital signal, okay? Expressed mathematically, okay? N, in this case, represents the specific sample in our recorded digital signal, okay? So in, you can think of N as a series of incrementing numbers, starting at 0, just going 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, okay? I'll show you that more on the next slide, okay? T then is the sampling period. Sampling period would be effectively the opposite of the sampling rate, okay? So if the sampling rate is 44,100 hertz, you take that 44,100 and you go 1 divided by 44,100, and that's the sampling period in seconds. Okay, makes sense? I parsed this out for you, basically, okay? Okay, so when we talk about digital signals, we can talk about them as a series of samples, okay? And so this is where the N incrementing, N 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, on up to whatever number it ends at, basically, okay? The recorded values then are set into the array, and this should look somewhat like an array for you if you are someone who has done programming, okay? So x0, we set the value to 0.0, okay? This set the value of the second one, which is actually x1, to 0.1, then I've set this one to negative 0.5, then to 0.4, then to 0.6, basically. It's essentially a graphing, a recording of a graph, basically, okay? And this graph is your digital audio signal in time, okay? I've put 5 samples up here, but this could easily be 5,000 samples or 5 million samples, in which case it's a longer audio recording, okay? This is a very short audio recording of only 5 samples long, okay? So think of it that way. Does this at least look like a time versus amplitude graph that you would have seen in Amadeus or Logic, or Pro Tools, etc.? Okay. All we're doing is zooming in really, 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 really far and talking about 5 samples, and those 5 samples have these specific values. Okay. Yeah, Catherine.
Why is 2 negative? Like, how is that noted on the x2? Do we just know x2 is negative, or?
Well, it's a bipolar signal, so it can go up and down, above and below the zero. Digital audio signals when they're inside the computer, tend to be between negative 1 and positive 1, and floating point numbers in between there. That tends to be the method for recording digital audio signals in software.
But like if I were just looking at, without seeing what they equal, just mm-hmm. x0, 1, 2, 3, 4, how would I know that x2 is negative without...
You're not solving for an equation.
It's just saying that point is a value.
Think of it this way. These are addresses on a street.
Okay.
The person that lives at x0 is 0.0. The person that lives at x1 is 0.1. The person that lives at x2 is negative 0.5.
Are we thinking like left and right sides of the street, or?
There's only one side of the street in this case, okay? These are more addresses, and this is the value that lives at that address.
Okay, you just pick those numbers. They're not actually like...
The numbers are arbitrary.
Yeah.
The
numbers are arbitrary.
Okay,
yes.
That's fine.
Okay. Okay. Did the address analogy help maybe a little bit some of you? Okay. Okay. It's what lives at those different locations. Okay. Okay. Now, I'm going to step up here again, okay? So I've already mentioned the square bracket means digital. So when you see square brackets in mathematical equations, we're talking about a digital equation here, okay? X means input. Y then means output, okay? So in this case, we have a very simple expression, a very simple mathematical equation that says our input is equal to our output, okay? That's what this mathematical equation is telling you, okay? And N effectively means for any, okay? So back to this, in this case, XO would be the same thing for YO, X0 would be the same thing as Y0 for the next page, okay? So when we have that N, we're trying to find an expression for any input. We want it to be equal to the output in this case, okay? So this is a very simple digital filter that does nothing, okay? Okay? Everybody with me so far? Okay. I'm doing this fast, but I don't want to spend 50 minutes on this. I want to get to actually using Max with you guys, okay? And if you want to slow this down and watch it later, you can do that, okay? Now, delays, which is actually our topic for next week. But delays are important for filters because filters are actually really, 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 really short delays, okay? That's big picture, okay? Really, really short delays produce filtering effects, okay? So when you see something like this, everybody see the difference between this formula at the bottom of my slide and the previous formula? Okay. When you see inside of the bracket a subtraction from some number, it's telling you that we want a delay of that number of samples. Okay. The D here is the number of samples that we want to delay the formula. Okay, so minus D is a delay of D samples, okay? Usually this is going to be an actual number in your equations. And you should have seen that in some in the reading last night in the, from the tutorials, right? Some of these expressions where you have inside the brackets n minus 1 or n minus 2, okay? You can mix addition and subtraction inside the square brackets, but it's best, it's considered a best expression of the digital filter when all of these things happening inside the square brackets are all subtractions, because it means they're all delays. If it, an addition actually means go into the future and grab a sample, two samples into the future, which that's a problem in a real-time situation, yes? Can we, okay? Because if I know what sample's coming, two samples in the future, I don't know, I have a time machine and Dr. Brown and we're talking about DeLoreans and flux capacitors at that point, basically. We can't know what's happening with the digital audio signal in the future, right? Okay. You can express your mathematical formula that way to balance it out and make some of the math easier, but in order to actually implement it, they all have to be subtractions here because that means they're a delay. You can actually look at the past. You can look at the record of what has come before and grab that signal, okay? Then we have coefficients that scale individual signals. I'll show you that is actually on my next slide here, okay? So looking at this again, if I cover up this portion here, right, it looks very similar to what I had two slides ago, right? Input equals to output. But in this case, I want to also add in, I want to mix in a little bit of the sample that came before the current sample in the input. I want a delayed copy by one sample from the input. And I want to multiply that by some value A, okay, and produce my overall output signal, okay? The output signal here. Does that make sense? All I'm doing here is this is a delayed copy of the input, and then I'm multiplying it by some value A, which usually that's a small number, 0.2572, it's got a lot of numbers after it, but it's usually less than 1, or less than negative, or greater than negative 1, I guess you'd say. So it's also usually within that negative 1 to 1 range, okay? Everybody with me so far? Okay. So that's mixing signals. That's how we can get various outputs. If we continue with this trend, okay, we can start to build out our formulas, okay? So I'm getting more and more complex mathematical formulas here, basically. But again, do you see the yn and the xn on this in this formula? Here's xn, here's yn. This is the input as is unaltered. This is the output as is unaltered, okay? But we're also going to be subtracting a sample delayed version of the output that's multiplied by some value b, and a sample delayed version of the input that's multiplied by some out value a. Okay, I'm stepping up here. You start to see how we're getting more and more complicated. Hopefully I'm helping you start to recognize the different parts of speech, so to speak, to extend my foreign language analogy here, okay. What you effectively want to do when you see a formula like this, start to pick out where the addition and subtraction and the equal sign are, okay. That usually helps you understand the formula, okay. If you can pick out where the pluses and the minuses and the equal signs are, okay, you can start to parse out what's going on here. Because each grouping in between those markers is actually a signal, okay. This signal is the output, unaltered. This signal is the input, unaltered. This signal is a one sample delayed version of the output multiplied by some value. This is the input delayed by one sample and multiplied by some value. Make sense? If you start to pick out where those pluses and minuses and equal signs are, you can start to look at the different signals that are being mixed here, okay? So you can build more and more complex formulas here. This is actually what is in the patch, the help patch for biquad, okay? They flash this scary-looking formula at you, okay? But if you look at it from this perspective, and I'm sorry, is anybody colorblind in here? I'm using red to differentiate the different, so I just, okay, making sure, okay. Hopefully everybody can see the red and black difference here, okay? Okay, so if I start to parse this out, it's really three versions of the output and three versions of the input, okay? that produce my biquadratic formula, my biquad filter, okay? And as I rearrange this, usually when you get into implementation, you usually want to rearrange this so that everything is equal to yn, because yn is your output, right? Okay. So what's the this comes back to just simple algebra. What's the rule? If I've got things on one side of the equal sign and I need to move them to the other side of the equal sign, what do I have to do to both sides? Yeah, I have to subtract them, right? Okay. So if I want to move this little clump to the other side of the equal sign, I have to subtract b1 times yn minus 1, okay, which effectively cancels it out, and then I can subtract it from the other side of the equal sign to place it over there. If I want to move this to the other side of the equal sign, I have to subtract b2 times, it's the same thing, okay, just think of this as a chunk. I subtract it from this side of the equal sign so that I can subtract it also from the other side of the equal sign, and if I do that, I get what is actually the implementation formula for a biquad filter, okay? And you start to parse it out here, again, the output is going to be equal to the input times AO, the input delayed by one sample times A1, the input delayed by two samples times A2, minus the output delayed by one sample times B2, the output delayed by two samples times B2. Okay? Does it look a little less scary now when I parse it out like this and make the signs red? Yeah, Christian.
So that's the output unaltered. Y.
Yes.
So that's like the whole equation is just pretty much canceling out.
When you do this, okay, and you alter these coefficients here, okay, and usually you use A to designate a coefficient on the input side and a B to designate a coefficient on the output side, okay? Altering these coefficients actually lets you produce different filters, different filter types, different filter shapes. So actually when we were using the filter, the auto filter inside of Live, underneath the hood, deep down in the code, is this formula somewhere. I've never seen the source code for Ableton Live, but I guarantee you somewhere in the source code is this formula implemented. Okay? Because all you have to do then is know which coefficients to plug in here, and you can produce a low-pass filter, a high-pass filter, a band-pass filter, a peak-notch filter, a high-shelf filter, a low-shelf filter. What else? I'm missing one. I can't remember what it is right now. What now? No. This state variable is a little bit different, but part of the reason why you can do a state variable filter is because it's one formula, and you can just apply different coefficients and get all these different filters out of it. Okay. So what allows you to change to those different filter types is having a stable formula like this and altering the coefficients. Okay? Now, that's a lot of engineering for 9 o'clock in the morning, I realize. Okay? But do you have any questions? Did this help demystify it even just a little bit, what these formulas mean? Okay, I'm seeing some head nods. Good. Okay. I'm not expecting you to become an expert in this, and the inevitable question in a college classroom is, will this be on the test, right? Okay, but looking at the syllabus, are there any tests in this class? No. Okay, so there's no test for it to actually be on. That's even better, right? Okay, I'm giving you this knowledge for your own edification, okay? Because someday you might encounter these formulas. Especially if you're dealing with Max and looking at the Max patches, every one of the filters has an equation like this to tell you what's going on under the hood, okay? Hopefully demystifying it and showing you effectively the parts of speech when it comes to digital filter design can help you understand what's going on, okay? Make sense? That's my only goal for today, okay? Okay, so let's go from something technical to something else. I have no segue here, sorry. Okay, so I'm gonna switch gears now, okay? We'll look at a few other formulas next week when we get to delays, okay? Because there's variations on this will actually produce some of the delay effects that we're gonna deal with, okay? Let's ask some sound design. I wanna start looking at, in our demos in class, that's where I was going with this. Instead of just simply looking at technical parts of the software, I want to start to approach problems that you might want to solve for yourself or for other people in terms of sound design. Because that's really what sound design is all about, is figuring out what questions to ask and using that to kind of guide your work to solve different problems, okay? And so in looking at filter design, in looking at subtractive synthesis, right, which was a term that came up in the tutorials, right, okay, I wanted to ask this question. How could we synthesize a snare sound? Right? This might, I don't know, have you ever asked this question of yourself, or are you just... These are just geeky questions that I ask myself, right? Okay. Well, I'm asking it to you now. Okay, so if thinking about the filters and thinking about the way, the readings that you've done about the filter design and thinking about subtractive synthesis in particular, how could we maybe synthesize a snare sound artificially? Yeah, Daniel.
Like bandpassing noise.
Ah, bandpassing noise. Okay, he's... Hit on right. Okay, so what is it about bandpass filters and noise that leads you in that direction?
I usually snares are just like one band of sound, like usually like a mid frequency. You can do that with noise, and I don't know why noise specifically, but I can't explain that part.
Okay. Yeah, Nico.
It's an attractive synthesis, right? It's the way that you're doing it with the noise.
Uh huh. Yeah, so we're the subtractive synthesis, right? When we start with noise, we're starting with all energy across all frequencies. If we then apply a bandpass filter, we can start to shape it into a certain region, right? And snare is a noisy, it's more on the noisy side of the spectrum, right? If we contrast a snare with a clarinet, right? Okay. Snare is definitely a noisier sound than a clarinet, right? Clarinet is more of a tonal instrument. It has a pitch to it, okay? Can we agree on that? Okay. So let's see. Any other comments on like strategies for a snare? We've got kind of the tonal flavor of it. What about? Yeah, the envelope. Okay. Talk to me about the envelope of a snare.
Strong attack and sustain very
Yeah, it doesn't really have a sustain, right?
Yeah, it doesn't.
Okay. It's really just a burst.
Yeah.
Okay. That's one of the reasons I wanted to kind of focus in on this question, right? The sustain makes it a little more complicated, right? Sustain is more, think of it this way. Some wind instruments tend to have more sustain, right? Or voice has sustain, right? We start the note and we have a steady state that we sustain at, and then when we let go, it's releasing, okay? That's really the model for attack, decay, sustain, release. A snare is more of a attack and then decay. A bell is more of attack than decay. Anything that you hit and rings is attack, decay. There's not really a sustain to it, okay? What are some other examples of instruments that have just attack and decay? Snare, bell, piano, right? An actual acoustic piano has, there's no real sustain to it. It just decays. Guitar, good. Right? These are all good examples. Okay, so you have these kind of in your mind of like these instruments that you excite them, you put some energy into the system, right? And it creates a burst of sound and then it slowly dies away, right? These attack decay sounds. Yeah.
No, never mind.
Okay. Okay. So snare drum looks a little bit like this. I just happen to have a picture of one, okay? Okay. Well, this is not actually a picture of a snare drum, right? But this is a picture of a recording of a snare drum, right? Okay. And if we're looking at the bottom here, these are fractions of a millisecond. So when you see 200, it's 200 milliseconds. What are we talking about on the order of time, the time domain here? When Victoria said very short, but if we could start to quantify that, right? Because we can't just type into max very short and have it come out very short. We have to actually think about it in milliseconds. Can you read those numbers?
The attack is about 8 milliseconds.
Oop, that's not good. Yeah, we've got a very short, we go almost instantly from 0 to 60, okay, or whatever, 0 to 1, full volume, okay? And then over the course of, yeah, these are a little grainy up there, so I apologize. Let me go over here. Oop, no. Let me tab out of this, and let me just open up some snare sounds. Because nobody likes, or everybody just loves to take recordings of snares. Lovely. Everybody hear that? Can we agree that's a snare? Okay. Everybody hear this, the noisy quality that Daniel was talking about? Okay. But what about the kind of ringing aspect of it? Is there a pitch there? There's a little bit, right? But it's not as pitched as a clarinet, a flute, a trumpet, horn, right? Can we agree on that? Yeah, Solomon.
About 12 different pieces of metal rattling, so we're not going to get a single pitch out of it for sure.
Right. Okay. Let me hear. Here's another snare. How would we describe the difference between that first one and the second one? Goopier, okay. I heard some other over there. Was it Maggie? Were you talking about?
Yeah, I was just saying it has a lot more frequency, so it's a little bit more like complex, like more similar to white noise.
Yeah, it's noisier, right?
Yeah.
There's less of a definitive pitch to it. And it's also louder for longer. So this is definitely, I would say this is probably a compressed snare because transition from loud to soft is extended in a way, so there's some sort of compression on this snare sample as opposed to this one, okay? But you can definitely hear kind of the traits of the noisy quality, okay? And this, we've gotten at the amplitude problem, right? the envelope problem, okay? This idea that it goes quickly to loud and then decays away over a longer period of time. In this case, this is like 250 milliseconds and 300 milliseconds, so we want it to kind of decay over that amount of time, okay? So we've got kind of the parameters. We need some element of noise, we need some element of pitch that we can kind of control ringing, right? And we need to control the envelope, okay? Those three parts, okay? So let's head over to Max, okay? And if you haven't already, I've got a patch that's there as a starting point. I don't know that you necessarily need it because it's got some of the same elements of the other point. So you can either go to Blackboard and copy over the starting patch that I've got, or you can build this up pretty quickly for yourself. Okay, so let's start with some noise sources. What do we have here in terms of noise sources in our Max patch? I've given you three options here. Pink noise, okay. What's the difference between pink? So noise tilde is going to be white noise. I don't know why it didn't end up getting called white tilde, but it's noise tilde, okay. That's going to be our white noise generator. Pink is our pink noise generator. What's the key difference between white noise and pink noise, those that know? Yeah, Catherine?
Pink emphasizes the octaves,
yeah. Pink is equal energy per octave rather than equal energy per 100 hertz even frequency band, okay? So the idea of pink noise ends up sounding what? If we had to, well, let's just do it this way. Hey, I just went back to that. I didn't want to do that. Okay. Rather than guess at it, let's make a quick connection here. So here's pink. Oh, I'm going to do it this way just to turn it on. Okay. There's pink noise. And then I'm going to do white noise. How would we describe the difference between those two?
Pink has a lower pitch range.
Yeah, it feels lower, right? We've got lower, more frequency, more energy in the lower frequencies in pink noise. Okay. Is that what we want for our snare sound? Probably not.
Depends on which genre.
Okay, yeah, and it depends on our target, right, of what we want our snare to eventually sound like, okay? I don't know that there's an absolute right answer, but know that you're going to get this difference on the input side, right, when you start with a white noise generator versus a pink noise generator, okay? Okay, so let's take a vote. How many people want to start with white noise? How many people want to start with pink noise? Wow. Okay. I think that was kind of even, and there's a bunch of people that didn't vote. You're voting for a third party candidate, Rand. Is that what you're doing, or?
Biased because of white noise and it's harsher on
that. Ah. Okay. How many people? White noise. Hands up high. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7. How many people? Pink noise. 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. It's 7 to 7, and the rest of you are not voting. Okay. Wow. Okay. I'm gonna start with noise. If we need to switch it out later, we can always switch it out later. Okay. I'm moving it over to this multiplication object. I'm doing that because I'm going to use the multiply object to actually apply my envelope to this sound. Okay? So I've got a multiply object, and then the only reason I have the plus object is so I don't have to keep, I can mix sources here, basically. That's the only reason I have the plus object there. And the nice thing about the plus object is I know it has two inlets, but you don't have it basically mixes anything you connect to it. So if you have one thing connected to it, or you have 20 things connected to it, or you have 200 things connected to it, it mixes all of those sources together for you and then outputs them. Okay, so that's what all the plus object is doing here. Okay, it just gives me a connection point, so I don't have to keep connecting and disconnecting two things here. Okay, for my easy DAC. Okay, so I've got my noise source there. I want to apply an envelope to it. Okay. There is the ADSR envelope, but I actually want to use something a little bit simpler today. Okay, so go ahead and create a new object, line tilde. And if you want, if you're not familiar with this object, you can go ahead and open up the help patch. Who's familiar with the line object and can give us a little bit of a primer on what it does? Anybody know line tilde from your working through the tutorials? Nobody? Oh, I didn't want to go that far out. I want to go like that. Well, let's do this. If I turn this on, which I'm going to turn it down because I've got sound. Okay. If I take this signal and I ramp up to 1.5 and that. Okay. Right now it's going to go. Okay. I actually want to use the list input. So if you're looking at the help patches, you may, hopefully you've noticed the help patches have tabs on them. So go over to list input, and I'm going to use this format here, basically. You can start this audio and look at the output, but if I send it a list, 0, 1, 2000, basically what I'm telling you is start at 0, and then go to 1 over 2000 milliseconds. There it goes. Lovely, okay? And if I give it this kind of list, 0, 1, 2000, 0, 2000, I'm basically telling it start at 0, then go to 1 over 2000 milliseconds, or 2 seconds to those of us that are not computer programmers, right? And then go to 0 over 2000 milliseconds. And so it's going to go up and then back down. And if you want, I'm going to disconnect this. I'll type in a scope object, and I can graph this so you can see it actually do this over time. So if I click this object, watch it ramp up and then ramp back down. Look, Ma, no hands, okay? It's a lovely little envelope generator, okay? Well, we need a simple attack and decay, and we don't need to change the values very much, which is what we're going to do today, okay? So I'm going to close this. I don't want to save it. I'm going to go back here. Okay, I've got a line tilde object. I'm going to patch that into my multiply object. Okay, so I can multiply the noise by my envelope, okay? And I need to describe the envelope of my snare, right? Which I had on my slides back here. So what do we decide? We need to go from 0 up to 1 over how many milliseconds? 10? Okay, let's try 10, okay? And then we want to go from 1 back down to 0 over how many milliseconds? 300? 250? We can adjust the, we don't have to, I mean, we're not locked in stone. That's the beauty of programming the computer to ourselves, right? We can adjust, we can try things out, okay? Let's start, you want to start with 250? Let's start with 250, okay? So back over in Max, okay, we have to describe this envelope with a message, okay? So the M key is for creating messages rather than the N key. I have to be specific here because it's hard to hear the difference between M and N. N for new object, M for message. Make sense? That's how you can kind of remember it in your brain, okay? So I want to type a message here that says start at 0, and then I want you to go to 1 over 10 milliseconds, and then I want you to go back to 0 over 250 milliseconds. That's what this message means. So 0, comma, space 1, space 10. Do I need to speak out all the spaces, or can you see that on the screen? You can see that on the screen? Okay. So all my line is doing now is applying my envelope. Okay. And if you turn this on now, okay, and click this message when you have to lock the patch and click this message, you should get a little burst of noise. How are we doing? Does it sound snare-ish? What now?
Just the snare wires.
Okay, so yeah, it's the noise rattler on the other side of the snare, right? The body of the instrument, right, is what gives it that ringing sound, okay? And so we want to have that that ringing sound, okay? This is where the filter comes in, okay? So if we want something that's going to ring a little bit, what might we want from our choices of filters over here? Does anybody remember? Anybody who looked through the tutorials? What else? Well, low res is going to be. You can use the help. This is where maybe help patches come in handy, right? You can do this and click on the help patch and take a look at it. Low res is a low pass filter, and it's resonant, so that's good. We can try it. So I'm going to drop this in here. I'm going to take it. And I need something to change the cutoff frequency. So I'll just create a number box. Okay. Oh, let's try 300. I don't know. Just start a number here. How'd we do? Does it sound more or less? Let's start there. Does it sound more or less snare-ish? Less snare-ish, okay? Can we agree on that? It sounds like some kind of drum, but I don't know that it sounds like a snare. Maybe let's adjust this. So we're changing the cutoff frequency, trying to get it to be higher pitched. I don't know if that's what we want, okay? Let's try this real quick. Maybe we put it in the wrong spot. I'm going to try putting it on the other side of my envelope because this actually will make a difference in terms of the ringing quality. I don't know. I don't know that I like that. Let's maybe try a different type of filter, okay? What do you guys want to try next? Raison? A resonant filter? So let's do that. It's a resonant bypass filter. Let's see. Oh, undo. One thing you can do that will save you some time patching, okay? And I may have mentioned this before. If you click on an object that you know you want to replace in your signal chain, copy it first. So I'm going to do Apple C. But then if I click on the object I want to replace, I can actually go to Edit, Paste, Replace, and it puts it right back. It puts it right in there with that where that object is. Okay, that'll save you some time patching. Somebody's got something really ringing there. So. Am I not getting? Oh, I have to send this number in again. No? I'm not getting any sound out of it. I have the right numbers checked up here. Let's see. Oh, that's the input gain. Yeah, I don't want an input gain of 3,000. I want the center frequency to be 3,000. Sorry about that. That might be the reason for the ringing that someone was getting over there. No. So we've killed this resin filter. I'm getting no sound out here. Okay. I'm watching the time, and I want to get one more thing in before we go too far. So I'm going to switch real quick to, let's see, I'm going to do this. And you can, if you've got it downloaded from the, I've got my cheat sheet here. I was actually going to work a little bit with the state variable filter, because the nice thing about the state variable filter, you get a low pass, high pass, and band pass all in one object. Okay, so I'm going to open this up, and I'm going to unlock and copy and paste this. And I do need the envelope, because that's not part of that patch. And if I paste it, there it is. Wow, okay. It's in my cheat sheet folder is where it is. Okay. So now I've got a state variable filter that I can control the center frequency. Let's see. Let's make that to, I don't know, 1,000. And we'll make this 0.8 for resonance. Wow, we're getting a lot of signal there. So I can turn down the low pass and then the high pass individually, and I can keep up the band pass so I get some ringing quality. And if I hit it now, we turn down the low even more. Turn up the... Maybe 1,000 is not what I want. I can tune this. Okay, I don't know. There's no one solution to this, but you're in the ballpark for creating... You see how we're kind of combining elements to get this facsimile of a snare drum, okay? We've got the noisy quality being generated by our noise generator up here. We've got the ringing quality being created by our filter, okay? And then we're applying this envelope to it to get this burst of sound, okay? Now, filters are not just for audio, or let's see. Filters can actually help us create control signals like envelopes, okay? And so if you look in this folder, I've actually got another filter here in place that's creating an envelope follower for me. This is gets back to, Casey, last week you were asking me about, vocoders, right?
Yeah.
Okay. The basis of a vocoder is an envelope follower, okay? And this simple patch inside of the sub-patch that I have here for you is a simple envelope follower created in Max, okay? We first need to take the average of the signal and turn it into a unipolar signal. That's what this object does. Then at the bottom, the last thing we need to do, we need a low-pass filter that's set to something like 20 hertz. So literally, you can think of the envelope as a really super low frequency that's sub-audio, okay? That's what it's doing. And then in between them, I've got what's called a non-linear filter, okay? This slide object. It actually treats signals differently whether they're increasing or decreasing. That's the non-linear part. Okay, biquad, state variable, low res, reson, they all treat all signals equally. Okay, it's democratic. Okay, slide is undemocratic. If it's increasing, it treats them one way. If it's decreasing, it treats them another way. That's what the slide object does. And while you're packing up, let me just repatch this, and you can play around with this on your own later. But this effectively allows you to get an envelope from a microphone, which is kind of cool, because then instead of getting these little bursts of sound, if I paste this in here, rearrange things a little bit, let me get these noise sources out of the way, and I will paste this final patch up on Blackboard as well. Okay, but now, okay, my voice is now controlling the snare. If I do this, oh, it worked a lot better in testing. I'm actually tapping on my microphone to produce this sound. So I've got 700 hertz. Let me increase this to like 2,000 so you can hear it a little bit better. Give myself some high frequency content. Ah, it's not changing very much, is it? Let me try getting without the filter here. I turned down the low pass, though. I know you're packing up. That's fine. Oh, hey. Ha, that's my problem. I have to actually multiply here. Now my voice is controlling the output of the noise generator, okay? So as I talk, I'm actually triggering it with my voice. Yeah. But if you had a simple microphone, a contact microphone, I got a pretty convincing snare now, right? Make sense? So I had it connected wrong. I have to actually connect it where the envelope was, okay? So you've got the elements of creating an envelope follower and a noise like snare patch, and you can recombine these and play around with them, okay? I will see you all next time.